One of my favorite audience participation moments in my presentations is when I ask the audience to close their eyes and imagine a website. Let's do it together now. Got it in your head? Okay. Where is the login? Top right, yes? Where is the chat widget? Bottom right? We have expectations after decades of using the web. Stop reinventing the wheel. You're not edgy. There's a famous book on web design everyone should read. The title is just four magical little words. Don't make me think. Welcome to What in the World is WCAG? 2.4, Navigable. A quick note about this video. If you're not familiar with keyboard navigation or focus, you'll need to watch the Don't Be Afraid of Keyboard Navigation video first and come back. Focus visible. Just like a mouse user gets a visual message that they put their pointer over something interactive on a page, users who are navigating without a mouse need the same thing. Every interactive element should have a clear focus state. Focus not obscured. How much is too much? There are two separate criteria here. One is the AA version that allows for partial obscuring, and the other is AAA and doesn't allow any. As it isn't defined, I would say that it's about clarity of purpose. If I can't tell what I have in focus, it fails. This happens a lot with cookie banners. Chat widgets also take up space, so make sure you've thought about where it is and how it might obscure the page at each breakpoint. And that's even if you don't have it open automatically. Focus appearance. You can argue that focus visible and non-text contrast get you here, but I like clarity. The rules are a 3-to-1 contrast ratio, and the focus indicator must be at least as big as the area of a 2-pixel thick border around the element. That's what WCAG says. And it's AAA. I say focus should be really obvious. Thick lines. Bright contrasting colors. But if that's not your thing, use the Oreo cookie focus from Eric Kroes, thus named because this universal focus day goes black, white, and black. So you always have good contrast. We'll put a link in the video description. Bypass blocks. This is all about being able to skip over blocks of content that are repeated across pages on a site, like the top nav. It shouldn't require 51 button presses to get to a link in the content, or 174 button presses to get to the account login in the top right. Yes, those are real examples. Bypass blocks are not just skip links, but we'll start there. Skip to main content should appear as the first tab stop on the page. Its job is to move the focus to somewhere like right above the H1. So just like you can skip past the top nav with your mouse, users without a mouse can too. Think about why users come to your site and put additional skip links in for the main things they would want to do, whether it's login, search, or viewing their shopping basket. But that's not all. ARIA landmarks like navigation, search, main, and content info can help define areas of the page and make it easier to get to them quickly. Making your menus expandable and collapsible is also a way to bypass blocks. And don't forget nested headings in your content. Focus order. When a user moves through the focusable elements on a page, they need to follow an order that makes sense. Typically, it follows the visual layout of the page, but the point here is to avoid confusion. Here's an example of how this can go wrong. This form was designed with checkboxes on the side, so the focus moves from the text fields to the checkboxes and back, which is weird and confusing. It isn't recommended to mess with the tab index values unless you must, but good design practices should make focus order a lot simpler. Quick note, Apple's OS makes up its own focus order based on the visual layout of the page, so you will need to check focus order on another operating system, like Windows. Link purpose, in context, or link only. If I presented you a link with a text, a short history of our company, where would you think that link goes? To another page in the website about the history of the company, right? What if I changed the link text to download a short history of our company, PDF? You would know it was actually a link to a PDF and what to expect, wouldn't you? Link text matters. The A version of this is link purpose in context, which is to say, if you read the words around the link and can figure out where it's going, it's good. The AAA version says the link by itself has to make sense. screen readers have an option to list the links on the page and choose one. So it's worth giving some consideration to whether or not your links make sense, AAA requirement or not. Location. When you're browsing a website, how do you know where you are and how you got there? Here we are again, covering the AAA requirements that matter. This one covers sitemaps, but we're going to talk about breadcrumb trails. Yes, just like Hansel and Gretel. This is something the W3C does well, so let's take a closer look at their understanding docs. This is the understanding doc for location, which is success criterion 2.4.8. The breadcrumbs have additional arrows to give you a better sense of where you are in the content. So we have the home link of all understanding docs, an upward arrow for the guideline navigable that location is a part of, a left arrow for the previous success criterion of focus visible, and a forward arrow for the next success criterion of link purpose. I quite like those arrows. I think they add something to this use case. Typically, you will find it's just a greater than symbol to represent the page hierarchy so you can follow it back. Multiple ways. We don't all engage with content the same way. When you're looking for something, do you prefer a list of links, a table of contents, a sitemap, or a search box? One way is the contextual links in the page content, but the answer's in the name. You need at least two, because it's multiple ways. Headings and labels. Let me start by saying that this one is a little confusing because of how WCAG is laid out. This isn't about using them, or correctly identifying what's a heading and what is a label in your code. There are literally three other success criterion that cover those things independently. This one is here to remind you that if you do use headings and labels, they really do need to be good. Or, to use their language, clear and descriptive. Let's use the W3C's example. An article on how to write well. That's your top-level heading. Then, cut out useless words and identify unnecessary words are subheadings. It should be pretty clear what kind of content to expect in those sections. Page titled. You've probably seen a page title and not realized it. They are visible in two main places, search results and browser tabs. Oh, and social media. This is one of the times that WCAG and SEO are truly aligned. But setting aside the value of the title tag for visual users and SEO, the page title tells everyone what the page content is about. Can't stress this enough. It needs to be unique and related to the content. And since we all love using our brand names in our page titles, consider putting the name after the description of the content, like blog-silktide or requestademo-silktide. Front-load the unique, important information. Before you ask, no, WCAG doesn't have any rules for page descriptions. Navigable. Finding your way shouldn't be hard.